welcome everyone to our first panel entitled Art as an Institutional Practice. We've invited several artists whose work connects to institutional or organizational spaces of artistic practice to share their reflections with us on their work. And I'll start by introducing the three panelists. And after that, we'll ask the panelists to share their thoughts in response to a few questions. And then at the end, we'll have a little bit of time for your questions and discussion with our panelists. So I will start by introducing Emmanuel Ortiz, who is a Chicano, Puerto Rican, Irish-American community organizer and poet. He founded Guerrilla Word Fair in 2001 to bring together artists of color to address socio-political issues of relevance to our communities, and is a founding member of the Minnesota-based Latino Writers Poets Collective, Palabristas, Latino Wordslingers, founded in 2002. He has organized around numerous issues over the years, and he's currently working on the Parks and Power campaign, fighting for racial equity in Minneapolis parks. Pardon me. Our second panelist is Michael Hoyt. Michael received his BFA from the Minneapolis College of Art and Design and currently resides in Minneapolis, where he is an independent artist and an arts administrator at the Pillsbury House Theater. For over 20 years, he's been producing, managing, and directing arts-based community development projects and youth development programs while making art in and with his South Minneapolis community. He's received awards from the Minnesota State Arts Board, a Northern Lights MN Artists on the Verge Fellowship, a Jerome Visual Artist Fellowship, and a McKnight Visual Artist Fellowship. Our third panelist is Eliza Rashid. Eliza Rashid, thank you. Was trained as an actor, dancer, playwright, director, and educator. She tells the stories drawing from her own life and lens as an Asian multiracial woman who has lived in five different countries. She's been a Many Voices Fellow through the Playwright Center, a core member of the UNIT Collective. In 2015, she was selected as a Jerome Foundation Naked Stages Fellow. Through this fellowship, she wrote and performed In Between, a performance piece that explored the question, what does it mean to be a multiracial, multicultural, multilingual, global nomad in the 21st century? In 2016, she is a recipient of Cultural Community Partnership Grant through the Minnesota State Arts Board, along with Amara Siddiqui. Together, they wrote and staged Cloth, a new work that explores women's relationship to cloth, covering, and choice, and the avalanche of factors influencing that choice. Currently, she teaches theater at Linwood Monroe Arts Plus. She's also the artistic director of LMAP Touring Theater and the LMAP After School Theater Program. Please join me in welcoming our panelists. So we'll start with a few questions for each of you that you can each answer in turn, and then we'll open up the audience after that. So let's start with thinking about your own artistic practice. Can you briefly explain your journey to becoming an artist? Well, that's a big question. Who would like to start?
I'll start.
Please.
Excellent. Hi. So my journey as an artist, it was a really loaded question when I saw the discussion questions. And I was really thinking about it. Why did I choose to be an artist? I think there was an urgency to create. As you can hear from my bio, that I consider myself as Asian multiracial. My dad is from the Maldivian Islands, the Maldives in the Indian Ocean. And my mom, she is from Taiwan. So if you have to talk about the ethnicity and nationality makeup, it's very already just a variety of mixed bag of things. And then on top of that, I grew up in Bangladesh and I grew up in Indonesia. And it's only when I was 18 I came to the United States. So growing up, I went to international schools, but I didn't get a chance to see people like me performing. I have never seen anyone else who was of a mixed race identity being on television or in plays. It's only when I was 20 I finally read a play by an Asian American woman, and I've been doing theater my whole life. So having said all of that, it's always been there was an urgency just to create to be able to not just only see myself on stage, but be able to speak the complexity of truths that are happening in this world right now. So that's the short answer of it. And I think I still believe that's what's happening right now with my work as an educator, as a teacher, and also as a performing artist, is to be able to constantly hold space for multiple truth to exist, multiple truth, and multiple perspectives to happen. And sometimes it requires a certain kind of art, and it requires a certain kind of dialogue that you don't usually get unless it's through the arts, through performance, through storytelling, through being able to embody and viscerally and also physically and experientially. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm an artist. Yeah.
Mike, do you want to share a few thoughts on that question as well?
I think that drawing, painting, or at least drawing, has always been sort of my primary mode of processing information. So throughout my childhood, that was sort of what I retreated to try to navigate and build my, inform my identity, my relationship to the world, my family. A lot of my slides are sort of about my origins. A lot of my early work really explored growing up in Minnesota as a transracial adoptee in a white family, and sort of using art as a, I guess, a tool, a way to decenter whiteness in my life for several decades. But I feel like that started very young in my childhood. So drawing, painting became sort of my methodical response to negotiating my identity in that space.
It's interesting because I think for me, as an adult, my primary creative outlet has been writing, but as a child I was more into visual art. I wanted to be a comic book artist, but once I started in college having to buy my own art supplies, it went out the window. Pen and paper were much cheaper than all the art supplies, so writing became my creative outlet. And it's odd to me because I don't think I ever really had any ambition of being a writer. Some people strive to be a writer, though. Study and take courses, etc., get an MFA, whatever. I that wasn't an ambition of mine. I was an organizer and started out even I think in high school, but then in college just being a student organizer. What I understood was that, you know, we'd go to these meetings and rallies and rallies and hear the same old tired rhetoric, and then you know, I would come across artists, spoken word artists, poets, etc., who were talking about some really important issues, whether it was about identity or police brutality or war or political prisoners. And they were engaging community in an entirely different and more vibrant and dynamic way than community organizers were. And I saw that as a real, as a tool for organizing, as a tool for getting messages across and achieving political goals. And so I had been writing really bad heartbreak love poems, which will never see the light of day in my lifetime or beyond. But I remember going to poetry slams, et cetera, and there would be people who were writing political poetry and performing, and I thought, gosh, I wish I could do that. Now I don't know that I could write a love poem. But love poems in that sense. I think all of our poetry is love poetry. But so that was it for me, that it became, I saw it as a tool for the political work that we were doing, and had a capacity to reach audiences in different ways, different audiences, in different, more dynamic ways, and that's, I think, how I really took on writing as a tool for those purposes. And I got stuck with that, I guess.
Great. And I know that one or two of you may have images you want to show at some point, so feel free whenever it makes sense for you to get up and do that.
That's great.
So another question we asked you to reflect on are the challenges and or highlights of creating an infrastructure that supports arts and community of color here in the Twin Cities? And can you speak a little bit to your experience with that and what challenges you've faced and maybe what successes or opportunities you've also been able to build on? Do you want to start us off, Mike, this time?
Sure.
Might as well just
start. Is that all right?
Sure, absolutely.
So that, so I guess I will sort of talk a little bit more about how I came to this work. I kind of consider my arc as a meandering practice of perseverance. This is sort of the context of which I grew up, which sort of drove my work for several decades, actually. And this is sort of And this is sort of the context of what I studied. You know, I kind of trained in the Western canon of arts, and this really represents sort of the supremacy of whiteness throughout that that formal training, at least. So in my 20s, I worked as a color matcher in a terrible basement factory, and I started to explore matching my own skin tones and started tubing my own paint. And so for a while, I was doing lots of series of work using that as the sort of undertone and base paint of this long series of work, really trying to explore, cultural colonialism, how we perpetuate stereotypes, trying to understand my Asian American identity and my Native Pacific identity as well through my work. I did a lot of youth development work in my neighborhood, so worked with friends that graduated from school, and we developed a project that was really about job training and youth and workforce development with young people in South and North Minneapolis. My work kind of branched out to do more installational work, and then something happened in the 90s with my partner. My wife was reunited with her birth mother from South Korea. She's also transracially adopted. So that shifted our sort of entire life for the better part of a decade. We spent about 8 years traveling every year to bridge and connect to a new family, which caused a lot of challenges at home. But then a lot of my work became sort of about these tactics of diaspora and belonging and disbelonging and sort of spanning that great divide. And so these were really paintings that were really about mylar, that were layered mylar, so they could never really be one painting. They'd always have to be sort of separate by space and time. And spent about 11 years running a small nonprofit that's still going today called Culture Club, which is partnering artists with youth experiencing homelessness or housing insecurity in the Twin Cities. Founded by an artist that lives in LA, actually, Dorit Sippies. So a lot of that work was really trying to create a safe space for young artists to explore their creative expression, but also to do big public projects, do advocacy work around policy for homeless youth and people experiencing homelessness. Did a lot of traveling again, back and forth from Korea, and a lot of how we connected across language barriers and across family and generations was singing karaoke. And so a lot of work kind of grew out of that, trying to connect across a lot of those language differences. This is a project that I built. This is young people in Honolulu at a middle school. It was actually built and left there, so they still maintain it. Then a lot of what I think about these days is, where does my work live? And you know, the image of my family portrait, me being the one person of color in a group of 10 people, that's actually the ratio of people of color that visit major arts institutions today. So I think about what and or where my art has the most meaning, the most connection. So I spend a lot of time just trying to develop projects where I can meet
with my neighbors and folks that are in my community. So this is a portrait station that I take to parks and pick up soccer fields, and I just spend time meeting with folks, and that's also just trying to offer a space where people can sit with a stranger for a half an hour and have a conversation, which doesn't happen very often anymore. So. And then recently, been working on this project called Dreamsland, where we purchased an empty vacant lot near my home, where we are kind of working with neighbors to think about the determination of this space, how neighbors want to use this space for creative work, what kind of things they want to build there, how they want to use it, essentially. And so people really wanted to cook and be able to gather and organize and use it as a space where people can really co-steward it for in perpetuity. And then this is just a project that I did with my neighbors to make sure that we get to see each other every year. So it's a growth chart on our fence, and we get to kind of connect with all the kids every year, at least once or twice. But I work at a center called Pillsbury Houseman Theater, which is in South Minneapolis. It's part of the Settlement House. It's actually part of a much larger institution called Pillsbury United Communities. We have 6 different neighborhood centers throughout the Twin Cities. I'm sort of the, I guess, instead of running through the 20 different programs we have at the center, it's kind of an interesting hybrid organization where it's a neighborhood services organization, but also it's an arts institution, so it's a professional theater company and does a lot of work with folks in the community and also supporting artists. So this is a lot of the programs that we do. And so I think that, you know, when I'm coming up with a list of challenges and highlights, it was a lot harder to come up with highlights and a lot easier to come up with challenges. And being a hybrid space, you know, we're probably 60% youth and family programs for neighbors, probably 40% arts. And, you know, just yesterday or Wednesday, we found out that the United Way cut all of their K-5 funding across Minnesota. And that's, you know, we have 70 families who depend on that 3-year subsidized out-of-school time program and summer program, and so we're literally just freaking out right now, and that is sort of the biggest challenge at the very moment. But I think that, just move up here, one of the interesting things that happened about 5 years ago or 6 years ago is that our co-directors of the center, after the economic crash in 2009, they had to merge the center from being a neighborhood services center and the theater, as they were separate organizations at the time. They merged into one leadership. And so the co-directors, Faye Price and Noel Raymond, thought that one of the sort of tools or organizing muscles that we have within the organization is creativity. And so they sort of took on this audacious vision to integrate arts into everything that happens within the center. And that it looks on the surface sort of like integrating artists into the work, but one of the more interesting kind of methodologies is actually using art and creativity to unpack a lot of the capacity of the organization. So how do we use our creativity to figure out how to do evaluation better, or our development, or fundraising, and to work through some of these thorny issues? So can we really figure out how to find this $200,000 that we have after school programs, and to build sustainability? But it's a challenging time. It's rough. A lot of those families really depend on those services. It provides affordability for families in our community. A lot of families are, might be single parents. They're all pretty much living within walking distance of our center. So it's a big hit, and so I'm still really reeling from it.
goodness for tech-savvy people. Don't look at that yet, I'll come to that in a minute. So as I previously mentioned, yes, as a kid I was a visual artist, and as a young adult and in my college days I was writing really bad, heartbroken love poetry, but really my personal path into being a political writer was, as I mentioned, started out with organizing. I was involved with the university's La Raza Student Cultural Center. I worked at the Program Against Sexual Violence, and there a few of us started an organization called Men Against Rape and Sexism. And from there, other issues that we would intertangle with began to influence me, and I became more involved in what I would consider to be more radical organizing, things around political prisoners, the issue of the Puerto Rican independence, and cases like Mumia Abu-Jamal and Leonard Peltier, police brutality. And one issue that I would say probably had more impact on me than any other was the Zapatista movement in southern Mexico, the indigenous uprising against the Mexican government and against globalization, which announced itself to the world on January 1st, 1994, when I was about 19 years old. I had the opportunity to travel to Chiapas to dialogue with the Zapatistas on two occasions, one being the new year, 98-99, and again in 2000-2001, with an organization called Estación Libre, which was specifically organizers of color from the United States and Canada, and indigenous organizers. And coming out of that second encounter with the Zapatistas, the leaders of the organization asked if we would be able to do some fundraising for Estación Libre. They had a permanent presence in the region with which they would do their work and their delegations. And so I had this idea, and I had seen similar stuff. I participated in the event Mumia 911 previously, which was to raise awareness around the case of a former Black Panther and MOVE member and current political prisoner Mumia Abu-Jamal out of Philadelphia. I had participated in that by reading something that was a communication between the Zapatistas and Mumia Abu-Jamal. So this idea came to me to do an event called Our Word is Our Weapon, which was which came from the Zapatistas themselves, and just kind of called upon friends of mine who were and currently are artists to do an evening of music, poetry, and other performance to raise funds for this organization, Estación Libre. So this work is, if you're local, you will recognize probably the work of Ricardo Levens Morales, the local extremely talented and well-known artist. He won't say he's a political artist, but he's an artist. A lot of his stuff is around labor and other really important movements. So he designed this event poster, and the event was, I thought, so successful. We raised a significant amount of money, more than I anticipated, for the organization, that I decided to sort of make it an ongoing thing called Guerrilla Word Fair, which these posters here then are some of the other events. Oops, there's my name. That Guerrilla Word Fair was. So Guerrilla Word Fair basically was bringing together artists of color and indigenous artists to address issues of socio-political relevance to our communities. And all the money that we raised from these events, from the admission of these events, went to organizing around these specific issues in our communities. So there was no, we weren't out of 501c3, we never got grant money. Everything came from the people who showed up and contributed out of their pockets, and everything went to, other than the cost that we incurred, everything went to organizing around these issues. This event, Voices from the RIM, where RIM stands for Refugees, Immigrants, and Migrants, was held actually September 15th, 2001. So this took place 4 days after 9/11. And I remember as 9/11 was unfolding, I remember having a brief moment where I thought, do we go forward with this? And then really understanding that, of course we do, because these are the voices that we need now more than ever. And it was a powerful event. Some of the names of the artists are up there. Balfi is a is a pretty well-established local poet. I can't see some of the names, but really good people who all contributed, who voluntarily contributed, donated their time and talent to bring this event together. Another one was State of the Union. Aforementioned Ricardo Lemons Morales was part of organizing a labor conference in St. Paul, and he asked Guerrilla Word Fair to organize a cultural event for an evening. So we did so. We called it State of the Union, sort of a play of the word on what would be, you know, a presidential address and labor organizing. And again, local artists contributed their time. Thunder Nation is a local native drum group. Ed Bach Lee is in my opinion, probably the best poet in Minnesota. Loisea Barron was just absolutely amazing singer. She was 70 some years young. She was a receptionist at the radio station where I had a radio show, and she sang all sorts of stuff, opera. She sang this amazing rendition of Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child. Toki Wright is a local hip hop artist. And again, different, so each one had a different theme. These events took place over the course of probably 4 or 5 years. Some of Us Did Not Die was a tribute to June Jordan, who had recently passed away, and Gwendolyn Brooks. I believe they both passed from cancer, if I remember correctly. And folks who had been inspired by their work were asked to participate in this event. This one took place at the Loft, the Open Book Center in Minneapolis. So sometimes they were tributes to artists, sometimes they addressed, and then the money to this one went to a group of survivors of breast cancer here in the Twin Cities. Holding Up Half the Sky was an event that we did at St. Cloud State University, I believe. Women of color, honoring women of color, and again, some amazing artists involved in that one. It was putting into practice all the things that artists, you know, write about, stand for, and believe, and using their artistic talent, relying on them to contribute, to donate their artistic talent toward a cause, toward a purpose, which can be a very conflicting thing because artists obviously need to make a living. It is important, I think, that artists get paid. And a lot of times artists get asked to do things for free. We know that can be a really challenging sort of conundrum to navigate. I would like to think, looking back on it, that because I myself was an artist and the integrity of Guerrilla Word Fair and what we were trying to do, nobody was making money off of it, that it was raising money for these purposes, that was a big reason why people were willing to do so. Beyond that, currently I've actually come back to visiting visual art. And I say visiting because I don't feel like I do it regularly enough to say that it's a big part of my artistic identity. But we started a few years ago a figure drawing group specifically for people of color, artists of color, and indigenous artists. And we've been around for the last, I don't know if it's three, I guess 3.5 years. Specifically, I myself had been working as a figure drawing model and found that it's a very white world and that there is a ton of talent in the Twin Cities amongst artists of color, but they just weren't participating in these spaces because they felt so white. So it was a challenge to think about how we navigate whiteness in our creative worlds, and do we need to do so? And so we ended up starting this group and centering our own aesthetics and styles and figures and features and forms, and it's been running solidly for 3.5 years. And as I quickly glanced at some of the art out there, and I saw that there is a lot of art that really centers bodies of color, and I think that's really amazing, and it's inspiring to see some of the artists who participate in our group, because some of them are very amateur like myself, and others are well-renowned artists like Ricardo, who's participated, and other younger artists who are up and coming, who are creating amazing work publicly, a political work, Black Lives Matter, indigenous artists. And so it's inspiring to know that we are creating spaces that help them hone their craft. I don't necessarily take credit, or we don't take credit for the quality of their work, but to create a space where they can practice that in a space that is affirming and supportive of them, I think is important, because it does circumnavigate the struggles we have, the discomforts and the challenges that we have when we're constantly feeling like we're being, both as artists and as models, because all of our models are also always people of color and indigenous people, that we're not being exoticized, fetishized, otherized in some way. And so we create those spaces through work like that. So I'll stop there. Thank you for listening. And I think there's a Q&A at some point. Yeah.
No, I don't have any questions.
What are some of the challenges and highlights or successes, if you want to call them that, of creating arts infrastructure with communities of color here in the Twin Cities?
Awesome. As you heard from my bio, I work at a public school system in St. Paul. I work for St. Paul Public School District. How many of you here have been part of the public schooling in your life or taught at a public school? Can you just show of hands? All right, great. So I believe that everyone in this room, and this is just me assuming, making a huge assumption right now, but I believe that everyone in this room has an opinion about the current public school system here in Minnesota, whether it's in Minneapolis, in the Twin Cities, or St. Paul. Am I correct to assume that? Do you have an opinion about public school system right now? Or no, no? Yeah, we do? All right, so I think it's really important to talk about how did I become a teacher, and how is, I believe that that is also me being an artist. You know, as an artist, I never thought that I could make being a performing artist as an education, as a profession. I don't know how many of you are planning to be a performing artist in the future, but I think growing up, I was always heard that, you know, that is just a hobby, especially for parents who having parents who wanted things better than they had, partly because my mother's family was displaced from China and went to Taiwan in the 1950s, and my dad was the only boy in his family who got a college education, and there are about three boys and two girls in his family. So he was and both of my other uncles, they only graduated from middle school. Well, my youngest uncle graduated from 10th grade, but he got kicked out. So having said all of that, and this is really important to my story of being an artist and becoming a teacher, probably because my parents, it was never a question of whether or not I would go to college. And it was never a question what kind of college I would go to. Again, I grew up in Maldives, Bangladesh, Indonesia, and Taiwan. And all these four countries have been part of the colonized system. You know, Indonesia was colonized by the Dutch, Bangladesh was colonized by the Great Britain. Maldives was never a colony, but was a protectorate. Well, it was colonized by the Dutch and the Portuguese, and later on the British protectorate, and we got our independence in the 1960s. And Taiwan was colonized by Dutch, Portuguese, and later on, you know, right now it's in a really contentious place with People's Republic of China. So having said all of that, so coming as a Asian multiracial woman, coming into this world, it was never a question of what kind of colleges and universities, where would I go for colleges and universities. And it was very clear to me that when I was younger that it was important for me to go to a college in the United States, Northern America, Canada, or in Europe. So even though I never grew up in the United States, but there's the context of colonizer and the colonized mind, as well the role of whiteness have played in my education and my upbringing. Even though I grew up as the majority of the population of the countries of where I have lived. So having said all of that, so when I came here when I was 18 to McAllister College, it was given that I will study things that will make money. Because again, my parents were very adamant in terms of they do not want me to burden the labor they have to go through. So I did what a right immigrant child would, and what a stereotypical immigrant child would. I took economy classes, economics. I did economics, you know, physics, and all that fun things that I thought maybe I'll excel. And sad to say, I failed all of those. And I just couldn't give up theater. I've been doing theater my whole life. I'm a trained as a dancer, as a mover, since I was 5, and I was classically trained pianist since I was 4. And I just never stopped culturally specific traditional theater, all the way from Wayang Orang in Indonesia to shadow puppetry to Chinese opera. So I secretly signed up for theater classes at McAllister College. Didn't tell my parents that, even though on the paper my major was political science, but I have enough credits for me to graduate as a theater major. So it's only when they came to the United States, that was my first time my mom came to Minnesota to see me graduate from McAllister College. She didn't realize that I double majored in political science and theater. So she was very surprised, and she said, no wonder your political science grades are so bad. So I have to tell that part of the story, partly because I really believe that as I became an artist because, again, it's a choice, right? I could have done anything else with my life. And I could have, again, maybe did economics, pre-med, or physics. Those are the things I studied when I first came here. But I chose to do theater and political science, partly because I don't see myself and I don't see the stories that I have lived with all my life, with all the ancestors that live inside me. I haven't seen them being told on a global stage. So I made it, it's a me serving a purpose in this world by being able to tell stories that I know are true but have never existed on a global stage. And that's why, how I became a teacher was accidental. I became a teacher partly because I studied Augusto Bauer, political theater, since I was in high school in Indonesia. My family moved to Indonesia right after the Asian economic crisis in 1998. We moved in 1999. So there was still very much of an inspiration and a lot of new energy about the change of government. And I also grew up in refugee camps, not me personally, that is my privilege. My dad would work for the UN, so he was a refugee camp worker. So my whole life, and also, again, being an Asian multiracial woman, I have learned what it means to see myself versus, I learned the difference between how other people see me versus how I see myself. And there is a constant navigation around that. For example, here in the United States, you know, if I walk down the street, maybe somebody would just say, that's another short Asian girl. No, that's how other people see me. But versus how I see myself is, you know, Taiwanese, Maldivian, multiracial, Muslim. Those are just some of my identities. So by being able to clearly be aware and conscious of those things, I would like to be able to hold space for more people to tell their stories in their own words. And I believe political theater through Augusto Bauer can do that. And actually, one of the best practitioners of Augusto Bauer political theater isn't in a nonprofit organization, in my humble opinion, back then. Wasn't in a nonprofit or in a theater world. It was actually in St. Paul Public School System in Central High School, led by Jen Mandel, who is a white Jewish woman. And so I was connected with her, and I saw the way she just used political theater as a way to tell, to again, hold space and ask students to have ownership of their own voices and be responsible as using theater as a way of healing as a craft, which is so powerful that I studied under her for 3 years. And this is me after writing my own play, traveling around the country, doing quite a bit of political theater, even with Pillsbury House Breaking Lines program, that I believe that the best way for me to learn and to usher voices is in the school system. And so I went and did a traditional route of getting my teacher's license and became a teacher. I came to Linwood Monroe Arts Plus about 7 years ago because the new principal at time, I was recommended to the principal at time to say this will be a great person to start a middle school theater program. And he basically gave me a carte blanche to start whatever the theater program I want, I envision it. And for me, as somebody who is Asian, multiracial, who, I don't know if you know the demographics of the population in St. Paul Public School District, but at least in my buildings, over 70% are of student of color, 64% on free reduced lunch. And I will say that that will generally reflect the St. Paul Public School District. Having said all of that, but that is not the demographics of our teachers in Minnesota, all right? And that is also reflected in our building. Most of our teachers are, I believe, 80% white, all right, even though it's changing. And a lot of them do not live in the city area. So when I was hired by St. Paul Public School District, I was the only teacher of color who teaches theater. And on top of that, I was one of the few existing middle school theater program. So I really just have nobody before me to start a middle school theater program, and I just went at it. And that's how I created a theater program that is based on ensemble theater techniques, which means that even though we study the Aristotle's idea of time, place, character, plot, and all that fun stuff, but we do it differently. Most of our students are doing original play ensemble, and most of our students learn how to unpack what theater means in a more non-traditional Western way. And most of our students learn how to be able to use theater as a vehicle to start a democratic civic conversations among themselves, which I truly believe that's what I am doing. I'm not just because I believe all arts are political, but partly because of the bodies in which we possess in them. So having said all of that, it is important for me to teach students, especially middle school students, as well, I also teach grade 4 and grade 5, to be able to be conscious of the bodies in which they live in and be able to celebrate the diversity in which we live in. It's also very important to talk about, there are quite a few amazing initiatives in St. Paul Public School District, like the racial equity work, I think. They started, were phenomenal. However, where it is right now, I think there's so much work that needs to be done. So every single day I have to struggle what it means to be an artist, but whatever it means to be a teacher in a system which I think perpetuates white supremacy, but at the same time trying to fix it even though it's broken. So how do you navigate myself in this system, even though there are these amazing initiatives to be able to address those things? So so those are my challenges. But also it's just general challenges of dealing with hormones. I don't know if you remember when you were in middle school, a lot of people would want to forget that. Because middle school is hard. That's when identity politics really emerge themselves. I'm also the advisor for Gender Sexuality Alliance in our school. I've been building and building that program at Linwood Monroe Arts Plus. and it's been quiet. I think that's all I have to say right now.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So before we open up to other folks' questions, there was one other question we had asked you to reflect on, I think, which is what ways can we help to advance these projects? And who is the we? Well, the we is, you know, people in the room, the university, other artists, you know, the community in general. What supports the work that you do? Who wants to jump in first?
That's a big question, certainly. I think the basic thing is supporting artists of color, particularly local artists of color, in the work that they do, whether it's buying a musician's CD, turning up for events, those kinds of things. Just sort of being the audience and responding to the call to build community through the arts is a first step. I think, you know, it also depends on a person or an organization or an institution's place and capacity. It would be a different conversation, I think, if I were talking to to people who have a lot of money, institutions that have a lot of money, whether that's major arts organizations like the Walker or major writing programs. That would be a teacher of color wants to come and have somebody talk to their class. So I think it's all about who the we is significant. For I think those of us in this room. It's one, it's turning out for something like this. Two, it's inviting somebody to come and check it out tomorrow. Sharing that information on social media, etc. We have some, just from the work that I have seen, some extremely talented artists who have come from California? Where you're from Cali? You're from anywhere outside of Cali?
No.
So they come all this way from California. They're sharing their work. They're bearing their souls. I think we can create a space for them to feel welcome, to be visible, to be heard, and by inviting people to come, whether it's tonight, tomorrow, whatever. As for us, I think after a while you sort of get used to the barren terrain and the challenges of being in Minnesota with the white liberalism and the way that funding takes place, the grants and foundations and the struggles that we have with those, our own visibility, et cetera. You kind of get numb, I think. And so when somebody says, what can we do to help? I'm like, I don't know. You're used to scrapping it out. You are. I think just generally showing up, supporting, being allies in ways that that I hope that we know how to do. That I hope it doesn't take a whole lot of explanation, but sometimes it does. Advocating that artists get paid is big. Recognizing, I remember reading, I can't cite a source, but I believe it was more than 3/4 of artists who make a living as artists are white artists. Questioning why that is, particularly here in Minnesota. Not expecting people to do something for you for free. There's a bartering, there's a negotiation, I think, that can take place if funds and other resources are limited. Those are some examples. Advocating for the arts and whether it's legislation, et cetera. Mm.
I think.
Go for it.
All of what Emmanuel is talking about, I think it's been hard sort of being stuck in a nonprofit world, and there hasn't been in the past. I think there's actually really interesting models happening now, but there hasn't been either for-profit or alternative models that have supported artists of color in the Twin Cities or in Minnesota for as long as I've been a practicing artist. And so how do artists of color get exposure and build even modern happens within a nonprofit system. Even the sort of white gallery system is a nonprofit system here, and so I think part of it is building leadership and building new systems as well. But help us imagine, I'm just keep thinking about this utopian world making and like, what is this utopian world for artists in Minnesota? And I'm having a hard time imagining it. And as, I think so, a lot of the challenges that exist in the work that I have to slog through every day behind a computer exist because where you have a contract with a certain philanthropic model that we subscribe to. And so how do you personally live and work within that and reconcile that every day to show up into a computer? And it's deeply unsatisfying, and challenges sort of your, I think, imagination to build and grow something different. And so that, I'm sorry not to be like deeply cynical, but I think that there are needs for some venues. I think there are some things that I think Pillsbury House has served a role or purpose for our community. But there are always ways where your individual sort of values or your vision for how things should operate don't always align. One of the biggest challenges that we have is that we're part of a network of centers just like ours. And so, within our roof, there are structural or inequitable funding challenges that we have to negotiate. But then across the city, we have to give and take as well. Our neighborhood center on the north side or to Riverside might run a deficit in 1 year, and so the rest of the other centers have to come to an agreement to fill those gaps in funding. And that's a really difficult thing to negotiate. And a lot of things that come up are, where, particularly around valuing what programs are vital. Does the arts need to be funded when this center is working on immigration rights? How do you weigh those things? So there's a lot of difficult negotiation around that. And it's necessary.
Yeah, thanks for saying that, Mike. I feel like I'm in a really precarious situation, partly because partly because my artwork is teaching children how to create. And again, I work for this large institution of St. Paul Public Schools. So I get paid in my artwork. And because, however, a lot of times I see that a lot of artists consider teaching as a day job versus a real job as in being an artist. So it's hard to answer the questioning which is given, partly because I want more visibility of artists of color in our school. And our school is this amazing arts magnet school, which is pre-K to 8, where we have full-time staff of dance, theater, band, choir, visual artists in the school teaching the art forms. And it's better if my principal is sitting right there. But anyway, we also have arts residencies for every grade level. From 6th grade, we have Wing Young Hui coming in to teach photography. 7th grade, we have Melody Strong to do murals. 8th grade, we have Joko and Trista Trisno, who does Indonesian gamelan traditional dancing with every single child in our school. And so I say I'm in a precarious situation because when we talk about funding, I would say that I am in the authority because I work for a district. Oh, I work for a school which is recruiting artists of color, at least in my, to make sure that the visible art forms are being taught in our school. And part of that is being able to pay them well. You would think that I would be able to pay them. However, having said that, I also find myself a lot of times pulling money out of my own pocket. So that's kind of a double-edged sword, because now I'm, so that's my hat as the theater teacher. Now my hat as a public school teacher, everybody is scrambling. Public school is scrambling. There is another $15 million that are going to be cut from St. Paul Public School District. I'm just thinking about, you know, 35 students in the classroom, 5 classes, 55 minutes, 6 classes a day, and grade 4 through 5. I teach 325 kids every single day, grade 4 through 8. That's great. And then, so, yes, and then I get 3 bathroom breaks. I get it at 9:15, I get it at 12:43, and I get it at 3:10. And I don't pee until 6:30. So having said that, because I want to pay, so I'm just really absorbing what Mike and Manny is saying, Emmanuel is saying, I want to pay. A lot of times I have my friends who are also artists come in to my classroom. I pay them out of my own pocket, I'm not gonna lie. Mm-hmm. But partly because I recognize the privilege of, because I am making it as an artist, quote and unquote, I choose to do that. But now, would every single theater teacher do that? Probably not. Would every single theater teacher pay the funding for the buses so we can go see a play? Probably not. But because I recognize I'm kind of in a precarious position. So what do I need? I can't even think of it. I do see that public school system is just a small piece to this giant puzzle, this small piece to this ecology of the current state that we're living in right now. So yeah, I don't have an answer for you. I would like money like everybody else, but money is kind of not the option. Showing up is good, but I also recognize that a lot of us are exhausted. So if I'm this exhausted for somebody who cannot stop moving, don't have any children, doing well as an artist, like, how can I ask my friends who are even more exhausted, more tired to show up? I will, but I also want to give grace to everyone, because I think that's what we all need right now. Anyway, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you all for those comments. And I think you all did answer the question in different ways, which is really, really useful for the dialogue that we're trying to create. Mm-hmm. So I want to open it up now to folks in the room. Do you have questions or comments, anything you'd like to say or to or share with or ask of the panelists?
I have a question in general for all of you, and then I also have a question specifically from Ms. Rashid. And I may not articulate this very well, but I totally identify with the cynical feeling that I'm getting from you, being Chicano, growing up in LA, blah, blah, blah. But I'm just wondering if you could talk about that point where does one measure success in terms of the Eurocentric, white-dominated arts institutions and infrastructure who then start to incorporate and exhibit artists of color or mm-hmm. performers of color or mm-hmm. dancers of color. Mm-hmm. And is that a goal? Is that part of the priorities for the work that you do and mm-hmm. artists of color? Mm-hmm. I just wonder if you could, how you feel about that.
Yeah.
And then I have then my specific question for you, Ms. Rashid, was since you've lived in these various cultures, I'm just wondering if you identify with one more specifically than any other.
It's not a goal for me right now.
Okay.
I feel like the lesson that I learned from the 90s and from sort of multiculturalism is that was a decade of tokenism. What artists of color really gained power within some of the institutions that grabbed that piece of history and curatorial space. And I'm afraid that are we sitting in that same position today as institutions are turning back
ask, is it a goal? Is that, I don't give a shit about what the white establishment says, does things about my art or the art that my community is creating or the work that we're doing. I recognize we live within that context and that framework. It's not why I write, it's not for whom I write, it is not why I do this work. And I would even venture to say that when I have gotten any sort of recognition or anything, I've shied away from it and tried to avoid it. I wrote a poem in 2002 on the first anniversary of 9/11 that, because of the internet, just really took off, and I got a lot of responses from all over the world, and some invites to perform here and there and publish and whatnot. And I can tell you that my writing in the wake of that record, and a lot of that was, some of it was from people of color. There were some amazing responses. It was a young woman in Papua New Guinea who said that she read the poem to her employer, who was a Palestinian, and there's a line in there that references Palestine in the poem. And he broke down and cried. And that was a really powerful response, and one that I was glad that poem found her and that she shared it with him. And then I would get other responses. One, if I ever published a book, I swear I would write it on the back. Somebody wrote back simply, "You're the greatest poet since Jim Morrison." One, if you think Jim Morrison was such a great poet, and that there haven't been great poets since Jim Morrison, I really question your job. But I would love to put that on the back of a book, just for the sarcasm. But what I found was that this was a poem about 9/11 and about the role of sort of the United States and its allies and predecessors in imperialism and sort of this historical amnesia about all the wars that we have inflicted and the punishment that we've inflicted. What I found is that when I wrote in the wake of that attention that I got from that, was that it became very much, not big picture, but it became more about my family and more personalized. Because I did not want to appeal to, I didn't want to write poetry that appealed to everybody. And I realized the importance of telling our stories. There's a quote by Arundhati Roy that really helped me when she talks about, you know, how we have to go to basically attack empire, and by telling our own stories. And that became my mission, I think, in writing. I've written a lot about my family history in a way that I hope is relatable to people who need that, who never did see themselves in those stories, like you talked about. And that became my mission. That became a turning point in my writing, I think, to not seek out. I mean, because I think I had choices to make. Like, I could continue to try to write like that and aim for that sort of success, quote unquote, fame whatsoever. And I don't have any interest in that. I don't. Whether it's in organizing or in writing, I have zero interest in fame, but I think it's important to be influential. I strive for the work itself to be influential. There was a writer that came once and said, he asked the palabristas, the Latino poets club that I'm a part of, he said, "When you write, to whom do you feel responsible?" And I had to really stop and think about that. And my response was, when I write, I feel responsible to the stories themselves, to tell the stories as they demand to be told through me, and to listen to the story and to tell it. And you can do that whether you're a writer, a visual artist, a theater artist, etc. We're all telling a story. And I, you know, I've come to the point where fine, that's great if somebody, you know, outside of my intended target audience finds some value in it, but I don't have the energy to give you to have that, you know, to go much beyond that. And it's like, you know, when you create art, it's like having a child in a lot of ways, is that you have a relationship with your child. I don't have children, I have pets, I guess. But I understand as a child of parents that you have a relationship with that art that you create, and you have to, when you put that art in the world, you have to accept that other people are going to have a different interpretation of that art, they're going to have a different relationship with your art. And if you're going to be an artist and take in public scrutiny or public opinion and relationships, you have to come to peace with that. And I think that I've, for a long time, tried to do that. And I think I, you know, it's an ongoing process for me that will always be a tension for me about worrying about who my audience is or what other people think about it. And at some point, you just write because those stories have to come out. You know, there's no, you don't have that choice. And that wasn't, you know, like I said, early on, I wrote because I saw it as a political tool. But at some point, that gets inside of you, becomes a part of your identity, and then you do it because the stories are coming to you. And you have to excavate them, you have to let them marinate, sometimes for days, sometimes for years, whatever. But those stories need to come out. They need to be told, they need to be heard, they need to be, because it's not about us as the artists, it's about the stories. So I think that, and the change that they can make when those stories land upon somebody else who had never heard that, who was validated by that, who was affirmed or who was challenged by those stories.
When you say success, it reminds me of, here's a rubric of how you're successful, right? So for me, personally, someone who have trained in more of a Western-centric white acting methods, all the way, you know, any old white institution, as such in college and universities, right? For a long time, I have to learn and unlearn what it means to be successful. One of my mentors, Lori Collins, used to say, "Fuck the audience, Lisa. Fuck the audience." I didn't really understand what it meant until I started the teaching. Because as a performance artist, I was trained to say, "Well, who are your targeted audience when you're writing stories?" And that really is in conflict of writing stories about myself or getting the stories that I want to be heard. Because I haven't seen another Taiwanese, Maldivian, Muslim woman story being told. So, huh?
There's a ton of them.
Yeah, there's a ton, right? And so when I'm writing my own stories, when I got an opportunity to do General Foundation Naked Stages and I'm start writing my own story, I'm like, is this gonna be successful? Will people come and like find connections? Because who are my targeted audiences, you know? And demographic, so if we're talking about contextual Minnesota, most of the people who go to see theater or performance are white women. Can they relate to what I'm saying? You know, there's a lot of anxiety around that, but it is when I truly learned and unlearned what it means to just be okay with who I am. Not just being okay, celebrate it though. Celebrate myself publicly as I will celebrate myself when I'm at home. I'm understanding that success is not defined by institutions. It's not defined for how much money I am making from my performances, but it is defined by the community which uplifts me and vice versa. So I think that's what my measure of success is. And in regards to, well, I live in so many different countries and so many cultures, it's a body with me, which one do I feel more at home? I think as a person of mixed heritage, I choose the right to feel wherever I want to feel at home. Amazingly, sometimes I am more Chinese, sometimes I am more Maldivian. It's all about context, isn't it? You know, and there are sometimes I feel like, and especially with the current climate, I'll give you an example. The current climate, here in Minnesota, I am not there's a stereo image of what a Muslim woman looks like, sounds like, feels like, you know, all of that fun stuff. I am not your stereotypical Muslim woman. However, because of the current climate, as a person of Muslim culture heritage, I found myself that culture heritage, that part of me is more highlighted. But that is my privilege. That is my choice. So that is a really great question. And my family's love asking me that since I was young. And to this day, I think now that I'm older, I can tell you that I have the right to choose however I would like to feel as a person. Mixed
I was wondering if you could reflect a little bit more as a panel. I'm seeing at least four different models of being an artist, right? Mm-hmm. Your employment, you're a teacher, and so you know, you're 9 to 5 or 8 to 7, you know, whatever, theater, you probably sometimes work even later, but you have little kids, so maybe it's only 8 to 7. So, you know, that you have this kind of combination teacher-artist job that gives you a paycheck and healthcare. And then Mike, it sounds like you have two modes of being an artist. You're in the Pillsbury Theater's house and theater.
Yeah.
And then you have the work that you're doing in your own neighborhood, which is your artistic expression. And then Emmanuel, it sounds like, and I looked at your bio again, you're a full-time artist.
No, I'm a full-time organizer.
So combining in similar ways that Elisa is doing, that your day job is your art practice. Or maybe it's another, but I'm hearing at least four models.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if you could talk, you know, maybe there's more in your experience because you talked about your life, you know, in the path. If we could just maybe articulate that some more.
I think, you know, boy, artistic practice is such a...
Can you say your question again?
It sounds like there's different models
mm-hmm.
for artistic practice, mm-hmm. right? And all of them reject the kind of European image of the solitary artiste working in studio with the beret and the white skin and a phallus. Right? That's the Western model. So I was wondering if we could just maybe articulate what it is, those models that you've lived. Because in Mike's presentation, I heard actually might be more than the two that I pulled out.
Yeah.
Boy, yeah, I mean, I think about it in two ways. I think that I deploy my creativity across all of it. And I think that everyone has a creative capacity, like that's a universal thing. But then I feel like my art is a sort of separate thing. And it's hard to compartmentalize it like that, but
mm-hmm.
I think when I was working with Culture Club in particular, I didn't feel like that was my art. Just felt more like a way to organize and to be engaged, and I didn't feel ethical to think about that being an art practice. You know, when I apply to funding, I guess, because that's really the only thing that supports my work except for my job, I don't talk about my work at the organization as my practice. But I think that my creativity is deployed there in what I do. But I don't think that I'm producing art when I'm answering email and running reports.
Yeah.
I don't see it that way.
Theater is a very social form of art. I really do believe that I can tell stories, I can create theater if I'm not working with someone else. So having said all of that, you know, what I see myself as a person who holds spaces for my students to create their own artwork, to have their own voices, and that is totally about community. Who we are as a community, who we are as individuals, how are we serving the community, right? And who are we, and what are we? Those are the kind of questions I'm asking every day. And those are the questions I'm asking myself when I'm creating my own plays. So, you know, again, theater is just such a communal form of practice in itself. But, and I don't necessarily believe that you have to be performed on stage. I believe that this part of this, you know, how this is being documented, the lives and the stories that we've documented, you know, that's part of storytelling. But would I consider this art? I don't know, right? So again, you have to go back to one's personal beliefs. So it's interesting. I mean, sorry, I'm just thinking about your question as I'm processing mm-hmm. work. I may have more to tell you. That's all I can process right now.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever had a job that I was paid to be an artist, although I think my creativity or my artistic practice, and I think, you know, even going back to what does it mean to be an artist, I ask a lot of people sometimes, you know, raise your hand if you're a writer when we do writing workshops or we're presenting, and very few people raise their hand. And then when I say raise your hand if you write, and many more people raise their hands. So I think for many, and I'm not saying this is us in the room, but for many people, they have these ideas of what it means to be an artist, and it's these people over here who do it at a certain level, who have been published, who have been recognized, who have been, etc. And we create these divisions and these you know, elevated identities. And I don't believe that. I think I'm an artist because of the way I see the world. I haven't written, you know, April is Poetry Month. I haven't written a damn thing in April.
Yesterday was National Poem in Your Pocket Day.
I had a pocket, I did not have a poem. Does that mean I'm not a writer? No, it doesn't. It doesn't mean I'm not an artist? No, it doesn't. Because you become, you know, it becomes about how you see the world and how you engage with the world on a broader level. You know, I mean, poetry goes through my head all the time. It may not ever leave the confines of my mind, may not ever roll off my tongue, but it goes through my mind all the time in the way that I see the world. And I'm sure that's true of artists of any discipline. Like you look at something and you see the beauty, the ugly, the challenge, the et cetera, because you filter the world, you know, through your artistic eyes. And so, you know, I maintain myself as a writer, and sometimes I do feel like, man, I cheat like crazy. I maintain my status as a writer just enough to be a peer amongst other artists so that I can organize artists. Because that's where I found myself organizing for my unpaid work is artists. Organizing the People of Color and Indigenous Peoples Figure Drawing Group. Organizing Palabristas. Organizing, I don't know what else I organized, but to be seen as a peer, whether it was guerrilla warfare or those things, to be seen as a peer, I would write just enough that I would show up at a performance when I was asked to do it and have something to read, etc. And other people would say, oh yeah, he's a writer. And then as a writer, I could say, hey, could you come and do this thing that we're doing, or hey, we're doing this or that. And that's it. I'm kind of letting the cat out of the bag, but that's all I got for you. But it's a struggle because it's not well paid. It's not something I could make a living off of at my status, at my level. Anything that does come in is just added. But I use that in my work. I use that to bring in artists when we are organizing, because we believe that art has to be an integral part of political struggle. Right? So then it's being able to use those relationships, to capitalize on those relationships, to further the struggles that we're taking on.
Any last comments from any of you before we wrap up the panel? Anything came to mind you want to share?
Well, I wanted to share that I wanted to be a comic book artist too when I was a kid. And I may realize that dream once my job goes away.
Thank our panelists for a really rich
interview. I didn't think that would be in Jessica, because I know how much work and emotion has gone into this, particularly because of Jesus' inspiration for this. I think that's really important. So I just want to thank the two of you for all of the labor and love that you have put into this, because I'm sure that much of that has been unpaid. You know, you don't get paid to do this. So I just want to thank both of you for all of your labor making this possible.
So we have a short break here until our next